Pleasant good morning to all of you. Today I'll be speaking about rehabilitation of bilateral vestibular failure. Rather, I would call it as principles in rehabilitation of bilateral vestibular failure. The reason is it's such a vast topic. I don't think I'll be able to cover all the rehabilitation methods in management of bilateral vestibulopathy or bilateral labyrinthine failure or vestibular failure. Before we start with the rehabilitation process, I would like to just review, a brief review about the etiology of bilateral vestibular failure. We know the causes for bilateral vestibular failure. The first is ototoxicity, meningitis. Many times we don't diagnose it and we call it as idiopathic, and chronic inflammatory peripheral polyneuropathy and autoimmune inherited disorders are probably very common because the investigations are very expensive and many times we just label them as idiopathic. Next, what are the primary complaints in these patients? Most common complaint in this patient will be balance problems and risk of falling, especially in complex situations such as dark surroundings and uneven surfaces. Most of these patients will complain of imbalance. Say they are always, they will have fear of falling. Next complaints will be oscillopsia, the word moves as they move. And few of these patients will also have sense of disequilibrium, imbalance and dizziness. And physical deconditioning. Already Dr. Suryaprakash has already told, most of these patients, especially with bilateral vestibular failure, they are not really healthy because they are scared to go outside, scared to walk and exercise. Most of these patients eventually will develop a lot of physical problems like diabetes, hypertension, obesity and all these problems. And this adds to our rehabilitation problems because they are not really healthy. We cannot ask them to do all the exercises we tell them. So that is the problem with managing these patients. Next, the diagnosis. There are certain bedside examinations which can help us to diagnose, and sometimes we need to go for laboratory investigations. The bedside examinations we can do are Oedipus test, though everyone knows bilaterally Oedipus test will be negative. Then Romberg's test. Most of these patients can do Romberg's test, perform Romberg's test and very well with eyes open, but when they close their eyes, they cannot. They just fall. Then most of these patients will have a broad-based gaze because they want to stabilize their body, and they usually cannot perform one leg standing and walking toe to heel, especially when the eyes are closed. And dynamic visual tested acuity can also be tested bedside, just asking them to read a Stellan chart while passively moving their head. Any change more than 4 lines, we call it positive, and that's one of the diagnostic signs for bilateral vestibular failure. And also we need to do routine oculomotor examination to rule out any central causes in these patients. Now coming to the laboratory examination, video head impulse test, an angular VOR gain below 0.6 is considered, on the both sides is considered pathologic, and of course the caloric test is definitely necessary to diagnose this patient. Peak slow phase velocity on each side, which is less than 6 degrees per second, is considered diagnostic. And if at all we want to see if the otolithic organs are also involved, we need to do CVEMP or OVEMP. We'll not go into the details what is the about the diagnosis. We'll mainly concentrate on the rehabilitation aspect. To understand rehabilitation in these patients, we need to know how exactly they recover. Many of these patients may not even come to you for vestibular rehabilitation therapy, but many do reasonably well after few years, maybe 1 or 2 years, they'll be doing their routine activities. To understand that, you know, even without rehabilitation therapy, how exactly they improve. When you understand that, it is very easy to understand how exactly VRT works in these patients. One is central pre-programming. First is the gaze stability, how they exactly stabilize their gaze in a long run. First is central pre-programming. It is nothing but our brain start to predict the head movements. You know, before the patient moves his head, the just brain can detect that patient is moving the head, the planned head movement, and it can move the eye before the head moves. So that's one of the way brain can modify saccadic eye movements, or patient himself can modify saccadic eye movements. He can modify pursuit eye movements to stabilize his gaze. And earlier it was thought that cervico-ocular reflex has got some role in gaze stability, but nowadays I think it is proved beyond doubt that it is not really significant as far as practical movements of the head are confirmed, or practical movement of the gaze stability is concerned. Maybe in a very low frequency head movements it is helpful, but not in a real life situation. So if we understand that, it is very easy to understand how a VRT works in these patients. We, in bilateral vestibular failure, rehabilitation basically involves accelerating these compensatory mechanisms to stabilize the gaze. Again, the postural stability, most of these patients somehow manage very well after a few years or a few months of the insult to bilateral vestibular system. They initially, they depend more on visual cues. Because their vestibular system is not functioning, they may depend more on visual cues. Some of the patients may depend more on somatosensory cues, and some people may rely on kinesthetic signals from the neck for postural stability. So if we assess the patient by various tests, which cues he is dependent on, we can compensate for the other cues, and we can make that patient to concentrate on the cues which is not actually not using for for his postural stability. So treatment, we are going to concentrate mainly on the rehabilitative treatment. Of course, these patients in the initial stages, especially the patients where the vestibular failure has occurred because of ototoxicity, we can prevent, and especially the patients who have got autoimmune inherited disorders, we can prevent further damage by giving immunosuppressants. May not be for forever, but at least we can postpone the event of complete bilateral vestibular failure. Again, rehabilitation therapy is extremely important in these patients. And future directions, there are sensory substitution devices which other speakers are going to talk about. I am mainly concentrating on the rehabilitative treatment. One thing we have to understand is vestibular rehabilitation therapy doesn't work in each and every patient who has got bilateral vestibular failure. There should be a stable lesion. You cannot expect to give a vestibular rehabilitation therapy where the patient is having an ongoing damage which is occurring to the vestibular system. It doesn't really work in those patients. Patients who have got stable lesion, patient who is not progressing further, in these patients it works really well. So vestibular rehabilitation therapy, there are traditional methods which can be done in a clinic setup or in a setup where some of the basic instruments are available. There are modern methods of vestibular rehabilitation therapy where we can use visual biofeedback, sensory substitution devices, and also nowadays, so we are talking about vestibular implants. Probably Dr. Sunil Dutt is going to talk about vestibular implants in next sessions. So traditional vestibular rehabilitation therapy basically involves, already I told about that, exercise to promote alternative strategies for gaze stability, and exercise to improve static and dynamic postural stability. Because the deficit in these patients is mainly the gaze stability and postural problems, our rehabilitation exercises mainly concentrate on stabilizing the gaze and the posture. And these are the exercises which can be performed, which can be taught to these patients, and these exercises mainly can be performed by these patients in their home setup. First, we'll talk about the exercises which stabilize the gaze, to improve the gaze stability in these patients. So it is abbreviated as VOR-X1, or the vestibular ocular reflex exercise number 1 and exercise number 2. This is basically to stabilize the gaze. A simple test where patient is asked to look at a card or a visiting card or anything which is stable and asked to move his head concentrating on the card. His eye basically looks at the card and he moves in either directions, horizontal and vertical. So this is VOR-X1. The next situation given to the patient is where his card also moves, head also moves, but the eye concentrate on particular letter or particular diagram in the card. It is again performed in both the direction, horizontal and vertical. They are the basic first two exercises. The next is to accelerate his compensation by saccadic or smooth pursuit strategies. This is how the saccadic strategy works. Here the patient is using two cards and using his saccadic movements to look at both the cards, both in horizontal, vertical, and sometimes in the oblique directions. And this is anticipatory gaze. So please concentrate on this. This is a very important exercise. I'll repeat that. Here what patient is doing is using two cards, looking at the one card and turning his head. This basically is an anticipatory gaze. It improves the saccadic strategy in these patients. The improvement in the saccadic system, which compensates for the complete loss of EOR, occurs by this strategy. Next is smooth pursuit strategy. This is a basic strategy where he basically does a smooth pursuit, which gives, basically it compensates for the VR loss by smooth pursuit strategy, which is useful in certain situations. Next is the imagined target. Here, patient is looking at an object, concentrating on the object, turns his head, but he imagines that he's still looking at the same target, then opens his eye. So that is as simple as that. That is the imagined target. So just I will repeat the names. First one is the VRX1, VRX2, VRXIS 1 and XIS 2. Next is the saccadic strategy, anticipatory gaze, smooth pursuit strategy, and imagine target. These are the gauge stability exercises. How much time to do these gauge stability exercises? Usually 4 to 5 sessions, not to cross total time more than 20 to 40 minutes. Usually initially they start with 20 minutes total time, means each set of exercises to be done not more than 5 minutes per session. So like that, 4 to 5 sessions, and slowly he can increase the time up to 40 minutes. You can go up to 40 minutes for gaze stabilization exercises per day. Each session may be for 5 to 10 minutes. Next comes the exercise to improve postural stability. Most of these patients have real difficulty in maintaining their posture. Most of the times, initial stages of their bilateral vestibular failure, they are basically bedridden or they don't really go out of their home. So we need to teach them. The rehabilitation in this patient mainly involves the improve the postural stability of this patient. Just I will go one by one how they can improve upon their postural stability. The first exercise they learn is to get confidence in getting the balance. They stand in front of the wall first by taking the support of the wall, and slowly they take out the hand and try to gain the stability, because already wall is there, they're confident that they're not going to fall. And each of these exercises involve different positions of the hand and different they also close and open the eyes eventually. So the first exercise is just hold the wall, take out the hand support, try to get the balance, then they can narrow the base of support and again hold the wall, then close the eyes, take the hand out. So this is how they gain the rehabilitation in, they get the confidence of maintaining the posture. That is the first exercise. Next is standing with feet shoulder apart with eyes open. Most of these exercises, they are very near the wall. There is nobody to help them most of the time. So their confidence comes from when they are near the wall. They are confident that they are not going to fall because there is a wall which they can hold. So the next exercise is they are basically stand with the hand and legs wide open, and they slowly narrow the base of support, and eventually they cross the hand so that they get more confidence in maintaining their posture. Next is walking. These two exercises were basically about standing and reducing the base of support, because most of these patients already have wide gait or wide base of support. You want to narrow it down so that they function normally. Next is walk close to wall with their hand braced available for balancing. So they start walking, they are ready to take the balance when if at all there is a chance of falling. Initially they walk normally, then they close their hands, then they go the toe to heel position and they close the eyes. So all these exercises go step by step. Initially there is a good support base, then slowly we start reducing the support base, and last we ask them to close the eyes so that they slowly gain the confidence in gaining the balance. Then walking close to wall and turning the head to the right and left, so that the situation becomes more and more complex. Now they are walking, and with walking they are turning their head right and left, concentrating on different objects while walking. That's the next step. When they can perform the previous three tests, then we go ahead with the next test. And the last is the more complex situation. Then they're walking, they try to turn around. It looks so simple, but the people with bilateral vestibular failure have great difficulty in performing even these rehabilitation exercises, because they have completely lost their vestibular ocular reflex and the complete balance system. Initially, definitely they will have problem in performing even these simple rehabilitation exercises. So can we just do this and ask them to perform this in homes, or do they require some other additional environmental modification? Many of the times these patients may be having comorbid conditions. They may be old, they may be having arthritis and so many other problems, because ototoxicity just doesn't occur in everyone. You know, some patients who are on, who already have renal problems and other systemic disorders, diabetes mellitus, and the patients with severe gram-negative infections, we give such ototoxic drugs. That means that most of these patients have already some comorbidity. So adequate lighting, removing of thick carpets, non-skid floors, learning plan of movements, all these environmental modifications are necessary in these patients, and this that gives more confidence in patient to perform these rehabilitation exercises. Outcome, do they do really well? Perception of dizziness can be major deterrent. Many of these patients have that chronic perceptive dizziness sensation, and they may not be very confident in performing all the exercises. It is slower compared to unilateral vestibular loss, bilateral vestibular loss patients. They really don't do very well in a short run. That exercise have to be continued. And if they stop doing exercises, again the symptoms may come back. It should be a continuous process. The patient is asked to do exercises continually, maybe for a lesser time, but they need to continue, otherwise the symptoms can just relapse, and postural stability will never be completely normal in complex situations like dim-lit room or any complex situations like uneven floors. They really don't do very well even after all the exercises. They will have some problem, the vestibular ocular reflex or the loss of the balance system from in the inner ear will never compensate completely. And the future, we have lot of advances happening in the management of these patients. I'll go quickly. These are the newer things which are coming up. May not be in our country, but definitely in the future. Computer assisted rehabilitation environment, you can see there are different visual and somatosensory situations which the lab can give, so the patient can, there are protocols which patients can already fed into the computer and patient can get rehabilitated there. Balance near automatic virtual environment. This is just like the whatever we get now, the virtual reality box. Visual environment and postural orientation laboratory. And I think Dr. Naveen is going to talk about sensory biofeedback devices, that tongue electrolyte stimulation, electrotactile stimulation, so I'm not going to go in detail about it. And lastly, the vestibular implant. Probably these are the future of patients who have got severe bilateral deficits. Okay, thank you. I conclude my topic. Any questions?
I'll ask you and Dr. Professor Rafalkar also. Any experience of patient of suspected or unexplainable bilateral vestibular failure with HIT positive, with HIT negative, HIT normal, head impulse test normal?
In our experience, bilateral vestibular loss are rare, and some of them, they are curable. Lately, I published a case report about a case of vernix encephalopathy presented by bilateral vestibular loss and cured by thiamine supplements. The few cases I have seen with definite bilateral vestibular loss based on the video head impulse testing the six canals and vestibular evoked myogenic potentials. Some of them, they have been because of neurofibromatosis, acoustic neuroma treated by radiotherapy, and radiotherapy affected the healthy side. Gentamicin is rarely used in our countries, especially in Saudi Arabia. It's restricted the use of gentamicin because of its vestibulotoxicity and ototoxicity. So generally, the bilateral vestibular loss are rare. The other thing, usually the otolith organs are preserved. Sometimes the loss is not not complete loss. So, but to diagnose a bilateral vestibular loss, recently the Barani Society guidelines, they have some guidelines for the diagnosis. But in our protocols, we mainly depend on the video head impulse, because it really shows robust data on those cases. But I don't think that you can diagnose bilateral vestibular loss nowadays without using the video head impulse, or at least caloric testing plus the video head impulse.
So talk to Srinivas also, that many of the times video hit is normal, but cold caloric is gone on both the sides. I recently had one case like that.
There is a growing debate, still it's an area of debate, between the dissociation between the results of video head impulse and the caloric testing. And there is two schools. The American school from Vanderbilt University, they claim that there is two types of receptors and two types of hair cells. So in cases of Meniere's disease, one type is affected and one type is preserved. So that's why, and they claim that the video head impulse test one type of the hair cells and caloric test test the other one. So in Meniere's disease, selective affection of this one. I don't believe in this theory. I am more convinced with the Australian group work by Hamish and Jan Courtois. They believe that is especially in Meniere's disease, the presence of endolymphatic hydrops with dilated semicircular canals prevent the convection currents and prevent the heat transmitting mechanism and the convection current, which is the basis of the caloric stimulation. So it's a mechanically, because of the mechanical effect of hydrops, that they give reduced caloric testing, and they show preserved VOR gain on the video head impulse test.